My name is Karen Hanna, and I'm hosting the meeting today. This is our weekly Life Force Canada think tank. The Canadian Restoration Plan is focused on making sure Canadians are growing their own food, and we're here to share ideas, support you in creating agriculture products that can benefit everyone, and to stay updated on food security and water security. So again, welcome. We do have a guest presenter today, Lizette. She'll be doing her presentation, and then we'll have an opportunity to ask questions. Lizette is a lifelong learner with many skills, sets from her first year as a recreationist onto cabinet maker, entrepreneur, educator, nutritional, microscopist, acupuncturist, biofeedback and energy medicine practitioner, and co-owner of a wellness center for over 25 years. So after many years of counseling, Lizette recognized that the nutritional quality of our food had changed dramatically, and that in some cases, the best medicine was through food. Over the last 5 years, Lizette was looking for a new challenge and became interested in container farming and aquaponics for food production. Yeah, if you just want to mute yourself, that would be great. And 3.5 years ago, she joined Food Security Structures Canada. Their original mission was to address food insecurity in remote northern communities. But then the COVID pandemic arose and the need became even more apparent. Our mission now is to help as many communities ensure their food sovereignty and security as quickly as possible. So thank you, Lizette.
Thanks very much, Sharon, for the introduction. And my last name is LaCourcière. No quiz at the end on that one. I really want to thank all of you for taking the time to be here today. This is my greatest pleasure to be here to help offer solutions for what we're dealing with here globally. It's no longer just northern communities. So I'm just going to go over to screen share and start. There's going to be a lot of information because it's just what it is. But I hope I can address all of your questions and concerns. Yeah, there's been a lot of talk about indoor farming, and there's a lot of different types of indoor farming. I want to try to address this presentation to community micro farming, because I think we need to decentralize where our food comes from. And so that's the whole focus of this. And I think that's probably a paramount interest for everybody here. So we got our confidentiality, non-disclosure. However, if you are interested to talk with me further about your projects, I'm happy to do that. We call this a community micro farm project because there are a couple of key things. We build controlled environmental structures in local communities to address things like supply chain issues. We use eco-friendly, sustainable growing systems that can address climate change issues that we're already seeing, such as severe weather, pests, pollutions, forest fires. And our mission is to grow and harvest food in communities as quickly as possible. If our systems can also be used for revenue generation, I don't know that that's necessarily the focus here, but if somebody did want to do that, we do have yield calculators that show that the return of investment is within 2 years. And our main concern is that when we go into a community, we want to engage the community for what their needs are, not what we feel is there. So that's everything from site location to what you want to grow. And then, of course, using local people to help us to build these structures. And I'll get into that a little bit in a moment. And of course, local employment, because it's not us providing, it's for the community to provide for themselves. So we want to empower people and give them the tools that they need. And also that we already have some systems in Ontario already, but we're working now to really establish a template that we can use in other communities, not just for Life Force, but for social causes, social enterprise like food banks and kitchens and so on. So our strategy is that we're providing a turnkey controlled environment solution, okay, CEA, that's the term we use. And we want to produce a maximum number of yields 365 days a year. So our structures grow year round. And it allows for flexibility in crop production. I'll show you some of the crops that we can already grow. And if it's from a business perspective that it generates an annual income, though, there are hybrid models that we've been talking about with different providers, such as growing for the community in need and then selling some of the goods to local businesses or restaurants. So it doesn't have to be a purely social nor purely business model. So we can certainly help guide you in that process. And again, there's educational employment opportunities. Vertical farming is still a relatively new type of indoor farming. And there's only a couple of players in the field. And we feel that, education is key. This will be our future for growing, there's no doubt. And so we use basically best in class components. So we are not a manufacturer. We are out continually sourcing for the best technologies and equipment globally. Okay, so we're not just, we make a widget and we want to sell this widget. We want to look at what are the best structures that can reduce operating overhead costs. We want to look at lighting systems that are very energy efficient and can provide the maximum growth for plants. The same with our vertical growing walls. We want them to be able to be high production, and we'll get into some comparatives there. We offer microgreens. We talked about that last week. So we do have complete systems. And then also we have things like biodigesters that help to increase carbon dioxide into our growing systems. So the key thing here is the whole sum of all of our parts is something even greater. And that's the whole key about this. A lot of times people will say, well, I want a shipping can or I want a greenhouse, but then there's so many deficiencies that come out of this. So our systems are actually synergistic in nature, and they're meant to work together to create efficiencies. And so we'll dive into that a little bit further. So again, the problem is with a lot of the traditional greenhouses and container farms, there are issues in terms of how you handle the climate. So if you've got a shipping container, you're always going to be trying to control your environment inside, which means more insulation, either interiorly or exteriorly, right? Which means you don't have a lot of space on the inside. And if you're in a greenhouse, you have usually a high structure. And so you've got different microclimates at different levels inside that greenhouse. So that's, you're always either heating or trying to vent out the heat in the summertime. And those are extra costs that you're always trying to balance. Also pest management. So and certainly in terms of greenhouses, because they're so big, they're always having to manage pests. And in the systems that we're going to be showing you, we mitigate a lot of that. And so our synergistic approach coordinates the interaction of each component, creating an optimum healthy ecosystem for growing. So the agro tunnel, we'll get into that, supports the environment. The walls minimize water electrical needs. Our EMS lights nourish the plants 24 hours a day. We use biodigesters for utilizing our plant waste within our growing, and also as fertilizer, and also to help with our CO2 production. And so all of these things support each other. There's a couple of other components inside the actual tunnels, which help to mitigate fungus and mold and insects, et cetera. Well, we'll start with the structure. So our builder for our structures is called Green Magic Homes. And you can search them on the internet. They're based out of the United States and they're throughout Europe. They used a type of fiber reinforced polymer, okay? And these are actually cut into components. And you can see that we put them together and then we berm with natural material. So we use the earth for its thermal qualities, and then whatever the local greenery is, we put on top. So they're actually really blend in with the environment quite nicely. And at the end, I'll show you a build that's just being completed right now in Panama, the country Panama. So they're easy to ship. So these panels come in sizes that will actually nest together and fit into a small plane. So if we needed to ship it to a remote location, it can go. Or we can pack it all into a shipping container, and one container can hold all of the components for a tunnel. And literally all we need is 2 12-foot ladders and some wrenches and local labor to help to put them together. So It means that the materials are much lighter. We're not dealing with concrete, et cetera, that are difficult and are cost intensive. These are modular, so we can customize them to whatever shape. We can insulate, our standard panels come at R40, but you can go up to R75, so you can go into the subarctic. You can even install these structures in the desert because they have the opposite problem of cold. They're able to withstand earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes, and wildfires. So in the case of wildfires, just by virtue of the rounded shape, any fire would just whisk over the top and burn any kind of material there and just carry on, would not change the temperature inside of the structure itself. They are rated for category 4 hurricanes, so we know that they're waterproof as well. There's quite a bit goes into the construction of these. And they can also be positioned inside existing empty warehouse space, okay? So if you've got an old building that's there, that building could create a type of an envelope. So you wouldn't have to go to R75. And these are also, you can take them down. So literally you can set them up, use them as long as you need to. And if you had to dismantle them, you could. They're also light enough that they can actually go on top of buildings as a rooftop structure. So there are a lot of different ways we can use these. So the whole idea again is that this is purpose driven. I know there's metric there, but the sizes of 1,000 square foot tunnel is about 25 feet wide and about 50 feet deep. And on the inside is about 11 foot. Okay. So we're not trying to heat space way above our growing structures. And because the inside round of the structures, we don't get air pockets. We don't have cold or heat pockets that develop. And we can literally use a small HVAC system to regulate the temperature inside. Remember, we're using the earth as a berm over top. There's a rubber membrane that goes on it. We use a type of soy insulation inside of it. So we use recycled materials. The whole thing is based on low power consumption. So everything that we use, you could literally run off the grid with solar or wind, okay? And as far as water, we are trying to reduce the amount of water that we need within our structures, growing walls. And let's see, I think I covered everything there, low power, a few moving parts. We try to keep our systems very, very simple. Because if you're in a remote location and something breaks down and you're not able to produce food, then we haven't created a good system here. So everything we have can literally be fixed quite inexpensively. Does not have to be on Wi-Fi, but we do have an app now for controlling our waters, but it really interfaces with the device itself. Sorry. Next slide. So this just gives you an idea of what it looks like. You can actually see the types of panels that are put together here, and they can be customized to whatever length that you like, or you can go width-wise, and it can be as wide as you want. I mean, we recommend a base size of about 1,000 square feet, but you could make them as wide as, you know, or as big as 100,000 square feet. This just shows you some other configurations. This is without the berming. Okay, so that's our structures there, okay, for general over purpose here. And we'll go into the growing systems. So let's talk about different types of growing. So on the far right of your screen, you see traditional growing. And you can see there's a lot of water that's required to grow. Let's start with a lettuce, okay? And we know that the crop yield per square meter, that's how they actually calculate it, is 3.9 kilograms. And we all know where a lot of our lettuces come from, which is somewhere upwards of 2,000 miles away. And every time you grow a crop like that, they grow this big, huge head. And before they cut it down, they take the leaves off and they send it to the next distributor, who then takes the dead leaves off and then again, packs it and sends it to the next distributor. And in fact, there are like about 28 hands that touch that one head of lettuce before we get it at the grocery counter. So, you know, it might have started this big and now we're down to like this. So we lose a lot in the process of that. And hydroponics, great form of growing food. A lot of times these are growing on the flat and, you know, they can grow more food for sure. The yield you can see is up to 41 kilograms per square meter. And sometimes these are a little bit closer to home. We're seeing more types of systems like that in Canada, but typically still 500 to 1,000 miles away or kilometers. And then when we talk about aeroponic, I'll just explain that aeroponic is actually the water, the roots are not sitting in water. And maybe some of you have heard of tower gardens. Those were one of the first versions of aeroponics. And the idea is that the water trickles past the roots and then the plants can grow that way. So it's less water. You can see it's 90% less water than is actually used in hydroponics. So it's quite considerable. And one of our troughs is only about 5 to 10 gallons, depending on the size of the wall. So that's, and one wall, our mega wall is 720 quarts. So that's actually not a lot of water for such plants. In fact, we only run our pumps like maybe about 5 times a day for just a couple of minutes. So we let the roots dry out, right? Because the roots actually need oxygen. And then again, after a certain, settings on our timer goes off again, they just trickle past the roots, let them wet, and then they go on. Now, if you've ever used a tower garden, and I don't know how many have or have seen it, but what tends to be the issue with these structures is that the roots start to dangle down into the trough because you're trying to get more nutrients. And with our types of walls and lights, we don't get any of that. So it makes it really easy to keep things clean. And what we're seeing here on this chart as well is that our crop yield is much higher. It's 80 to 120 kilograms per square yard. So just to give you an idea what that means, one of our walls will be 8 feet long, 6 feet tall, two-sided, maybe 12 inches depth overall, okay? And there's 720 ports for the plants. So that 18 square feet now, instead of being on the flat, is on the vertical, okay? 720 plants and 18 square feet on the vertical as a lot of food. And that's what got us really excited, was that we didn't need so much space or so much resources in order to grow food. So this is what the walls look like. On the right side of the screen here, this is actually one of the panels. You can see there are 6 ports. This is separated out, okay, so you can see what it looks like. And literally, we can create any size. So these literally click together, and on the backside, the water drains in through like a little V. So as it drains through, it hits the back. We put little peat cups inside of there, and the water trickles past the root, and then it hits the next cup and the next cup and the next cup all the way down to the bottom trough. And then it recirculates back through. On the left-hand side, this is like a small home version. So if you wanted to grow some for yourself, I have one of the first versions of the wall, and it's actually a lot bigger footprint than this. I'm hoping to get one of these myself at some point. But nice little system. I'm harvesting pretty much every week. Now, just to be clear, when I say I'm harvesting, I'm not harvesting a head of lettuce like this, okay? In fact, the most nutrition in your plants are when they're little baby leaves. So every week, I just kind of go around and take the leaves off, and then they grow back in 1 week, and then I harvest again. So that's what we're talking about in terms of food production. It's every week. Now, this is a big wall. This is the mega wall. And you can see in this case, these ones have wheels, okay? And this is a two-sided wall. And on the right-hand side, you can see we've opened up the door here. So each side opens up and you can have that full of plants, open up the door and do any kind of maintenance you needed to on the inside. So as I mentioned earlier about the roots, because we have some special kind of lights, we don't have roots trailing into the trough, so it's very, very easy for maintenance. And that's really key, because if your maintenance is too difficult, you can start to develop mold and bacteria inside your trough, and you don't want that circulating around your plants. So it's very easy access and it's very slimline. So like if you just had one wall that you wanted to put it up, it can be wall mounted. And but this is the commercial wall going here, right here. So Harvest Today is our provider for these grow walls. They're based out of Colorado. They're currently shipping throughout North America. As I said, these are scalable. So if you had a specific size wall, they could literally make a custom size for that wall. And we know exactly how much distance is required between the plants without crowding. And that's really important. I've seen some growing systems that the ports were too close and the plants become crowded. So that's critical in the design. And another interesting point here is our germination. We don't need germination trays, okay? We literally take a peat pot and fill it with coca coir. We put two seeds in the pot and we place it right into the wall. And within a couple of days, you will start to see the seeds germinate. And we then take one of the plants out because there's too much competition if you have more than one plant, okay? And this actually saves about a couple weeks in terms of growth, because if you grow it on the flat and then you put it into the wall, which is on a slight angle, okay, then that the plant has to readjust again. So by being able to grow it in the wall, it actually expedites the growing time. And the other interesting thing is we can do multiple harvests from one seed. And this is really unheard of in the industry. So your input costs are very low. And I'll talk a little bit about that because that connects to the lights, okay? And then I want to show you, we can do all kinds of crops. I'll show you a crop list, but each wall has its own controls. And so depending on the type of crop plants that you're growing, you can have each wall have its own pH range and electrical conductivity range. So it's specific to those plants. And that's really important because not all plants grow well together. They may need different nutrients or different pH levels. These units, again, are very lightweight, easy to ship. They're made of food grade plastic. The plumbing and all the interior is easy to access. And they're very energy efficient. Again, there is a small app that you can hook up to your phone, which regulates the water flow. So, and that's how that's important is you don't want a lot of water drowning your roots out. So if you just little seedlings, you don't want as much water flow as when you've got them growing in full bloom. Obviously full bloom or full growth means that they're taking a lot of water in. But the seedlings, when they're first starting, don't need as much flow. So it gives you the control to be able to deal with that. So then we get into the lights. Our lights are manufactured in Canada. They're a unique blend of full spectrum lights and EMS, electromagnetic spectrum. And these stimulate the cells inside the plants, and it reduces the amount of water that they need. Now we run our lights 24/7, and this typically doesn't happen in the industry. Usually they'll run lights for 7 to 9 hours. I mean, we can toggle them off if we were trying to get them to flower, but in the case of leafy greens and some herbs, you don't want them to be flowering. You want to be able to harvest them. So we don't let anything get to flower unless we're kind of done with it or we want to collect seeds. But basically these lights are on 24/7 and it actually increases the plant production by 25%, which is very significant in agricultural world. Most times, like when sunlight even penetrates into plants, it damages the plants. They start to repair themselves at nighttime. But because of these EMS frequencies that are emitted, the plants like it and they can continue to grow. And one of the neat things is that they don't, typically when leaves are out, and you'll see this in your own garden, if you're a gardener, your plants flower or have their leaves. And it tends to be that there's leaves underneath that don't get the sun. And what happens, you have to pick them off, right? You don't want to waste the plant to waste energy on things that are dying. But that doesn't happen because these lights actually penetrate right through the canopy of the leaves and allow leaves to grow underneath. So it, in fact, increases our production. And the other unique thing is that because these lights don't produce a lot of heat, we don't have heat buildup actually within the structure. We don't need fans or air conditioners to cool the space. That's what happens in a lot of greenhouses. They have high density lights. They produce a lot of heat, and that's where you get those microclimates in different zones of the greenhouse. So all that money that you're spending to fans and heating or cooling is it an expense? And with our low ceilings inside the agro tunnels, we don't have those issues. So let's see, they're available for 180 degrees. So you can use them just against one flat wall. Or if you've got commercial walls side by side, we have a light that's 360 degrees. So you can use one light between two walls. So it's pretty cool. So what makes them so unique is that they are energy efficient. And we have the special electromagnetic spectrum in there that the plants like, and allows for 24-hour operation and 25% increase in plant growth and also multiple harvests. So right now in my grow wall, I'm probably on about my fifth harvest. It's about every week I'm doing it. I could probably space it out if I wanted to have bigger leaves, but there's only two of us eating it. So, but I've seen plant leaves, they'll be like as big as half as big as your arm. And so we know that these plants, we can do like about 1.8 harvests every month, which is really something. Normally, you know, the whole goal is to get that produce to one full head and you harvest it and then you got to start all over. But by these multiple harvests, we can use the same seed for months. We do have some plants like Chinese cutting celery, which have been going for like 2 years. And we have a test farm in Pennsylvania. They're already been working with these lights and walls for the last 3 years. And this year was the first year that they grew strawberries from seed, first year harvest. So that's really exciting because these things normally take a couple of years to get established. So we also do grow bins. And this is important for northern communities where they don't have enough time to grow in the ground. And so these bins work much like our aeroponic systems. And we have adjustable racks for the light so they can go up and down. But all your root vegetables, I think the last time I was looking online, it was like $22 for a 5-pound bag of potatoes in some northern Ontario communities. But this would allow somebody to grow those kinds of vegetables in far north regions. But it can be used for things like turmeric or ginger or other root vegetables. We've even grown dwarf apples and lemons inside of the agro tunnel. So by being able to control the environment, you can pretty much grow whatever you want, just controlling your humidity and your heat temperatures. Microgreen towers, this is what our microgreen tower looks like. These are the highest yield, high value crops that you can get. If anybody was in a desperation for food, this is the first thing that I would start with. So, I mean, if you're trying to sell them, they can generate revenue very quickly. They are highly packed with nutrients and vitamins, minerals. The seeds themselves contain everything that it needs to grow. Once so your first two leaves are called the cotyledon leaves. And then once the true leaf shows, you should be ready to harvest. And depending on what seed you're using, you know, that could be anywhere from 8 to 14 days. Some take much longer, but very nutrient dense. The best ones I've seen are sunflower seeds and purslane. Now, I haven't tried purslane yet, but I hear that purslane is very, very high in essential fatty acids. They're also high in sunflowers, but packed with nutrients. So if you couldn't eat anything else, this is the first thing I would grow. And in our system with our lights, you can grow 18 trays and harvest them 3 to 4 times per month. Each tray will be approximately 2 pounds. That's conservative. You could probably harvest up to 3 pounds with the right seed ratio. So figure out 18 times 3 pounds, but just say 2 pounds. That's a lot. It's an awful lot. I grow them myself. I'm giving away to my neighbors all the time. But I want to eat them, and I don't want to grow on a small tray. I'd rather have extra. So this meets immediate food security needs. These are lightweight. They're made of plastic. That's important because you don't want mold growing on any of your equipment. I know it's tempting to use wood or whatever, but do try to use materials if you're going to construct it yourself that's easy to use. And it's a very low startup cost and your seed costs. I mean, the biggest thing is seed, because you go through a lot of seeds. So sourcing a local supplier for those. Now, CO2 supplementation. Plants need CO2, okay? It helps them in their photosynthesis process. And when they're grown indoors, there can be a depletion of CO2, right? And it won't matter how much water, heat, or light you give them, they just won't grow. They need more carbon dioxide. So an airtight structure can be problematic. So what we do is we actually increase CO2 production inside the agro tunnels. I guess you could probably do this in your home, but I don't quite think it's the right thing to do. I'll explain how that process happens, but normal air is 250 to 400 parts per million. And plants can't grow in anything less than 350 parts per million. So we can actually increase it up to 1,200 to 1,500. And still, that's not problematic for humans, okay? So don't think that you'll be a problem. But these are very safe levels, but it'll give another 25% bump on your plant growth. So go back to the beginning. The synergy of all these things working together allows us to produce so much food in such a short period of time. So how do we do that? Well, we use an anaerobic biodigester, and you can see these two containers here. The first container, what we do is we collect all the waste from what we're growing inside of the agro tunnel. You can even collect it from within the community, other food scraps. You can go to restaurants, wherever you want to get it. Basically, we run it through a garburator, okay, and it goes into the bin and it ferments, okay. And when it ferments, it produces methane gas. So if we put it out in our compost, the same thing happens. We get methane gas, but we don't harness it in any way. All right. So basically, when it's turned into methane gas, we can actually burn it. You can use it for cooking. And in third world countries, lots of people do. They're a great device. In fact, our partner works with Solar Cities, and they do a lot of projects creating biodigesters for third world countries, because those people don't have access to clean fuel. A lot of times they're cooking over wood or other combustible materials that aren't very healthy to breathe. And this is a great way for them to be able to cook from clean gas. So I know this is a little bit of an aside, but we do support them for any kind of agro tunnel builds. We donate funds back to Solar Cities to help continue to provide good, healthy ways for people to cook in other countries. So back to where we were at. The biodigestate, that's the waste after the fermentation. That is now fertilizer. That fertilizer we can put back into our growing walls, okay? So we do reduce our costs for fertilizing our plants. If we have too much of it, we can give it away to the community, to community gardens. We can put it on farmers' fields, because everything that we took out of the plants that got all macerated and so on, you still contains all the vitamins and nutrients and amino acids that were in those plants. Highly nutritive value. So now we can put it back into the community and make sure that our summer harvests are even more abundant. So now when we burn the methane gas inside the tunnel, that's the CO2. That's what gets the plants really excited, because now they can really start to grow even more. So it's a win-win all around on this. So it reduces the need for chemical fertilizers. We use less electricity because there's a heat source from burning this. And obviously it can help communities to further their gardening programs. I know that's a lot of info, but hope you're hanging in there with me. So crops and production. This is a picture of our walls down in Pennsylvania. This is Jody. She's one of our master gardeners. She's amazing. You can see like that's a huge harvest. She strictly sells to shares to the community support of agriculture. And whatever she has leftovers, which is just about every week, she donates it to the food bank. And here's a list of the crops that we can grow. We're always testing for new things, but we've proven out the strawberries. We're working on the blueberries. We know that the small dwarf apple trees and lemon trees they can fit within the side of our structures. Some of the fruit, like zucchinis and tomatoes, you'll have to set up like a meshing system to cradle the fruit. We suggest at this point the mini ones, but nothing nicer than having little cherry tomatoes in the middle of winter that were just picked next door, or strawberries. Herbs, unlimited. Pretty much everything you can see here, but I'm sure there's others that we don't even have on the list. And as far as the leafy greens, I've grown pak choy, Swiss chard, romaine lettuce. You know, it's greens are greens. They grow very quickly and highly nutritious. Again, harvesting them small allows you to get a higher nutritive value. So crop production. So again, I come back to it's the synergy of all the technologies that allows us to produce as much as we do. And of course, that means harvesting local, hyper local, means that you get the highest nutritive value, most flavor, and the highest nutrition when you want it. In a 1,000 square foot tunnel, you can feed approximately 500 people every month. So that's equivalent to 2 acres of farmland, okay? But instead of it being seasonal, it's all year round. Now there's a lot of numbers on here about how many plants and so on, but it's like 1700 pounds of produce every month. What's important is what does the community want? What does the community need? Okay, because if they're not used to eating greens, then that's not the thing to be growing. But if you are liking that, then great. There's lots to be grown. So recommendations. I've tried to give you a couple scenarios here just so you kind of get like the breadth of this. 1,000 square foot agro tunnel and growing equipment. This is just a quick snapshot here, but you're in the range of $300,000 to $450,000. We have done return of investment calculators over a 3-year time period. And our calculators actually allow you to select a crop. We can tell you how much electricity you'll need, how much water you will need, so we factor in a full-time manager, so the time involved for, a tunnel is approximately an hour or two for a manager every day to manage the whole thing, okay? Now, if you had 2 acres of land that you were farming, you probably need more than one person in a couple hours a day, but that's all we need with our systems. Where the time comes in is when we go to harvest. Then we need hands to harvest it and package it and get it to the community. This is the agro tunnel, growing walls, lights, biodigester. We have a special paint we put inside the tunnel, which reflects more light and also prevents bacteria and funguses and insects from surviving inside the tunnel. It just cuts their feet. You still need to prepare the site. So you need a concrete pad. And there's still local contractors that we like to engage because they know the rules and bylaws within each community to come and berm over top. And we provide the leadership and the training on how to put it together. And then we provide training for the people to operate this system and provide ongoing support. It's a learning curve. It's like everything. If somebody's a gardener, it'll probably come easy. If somebody's not a gardener, it's going to take a little longer, but we do have support there. As another example, as a small startup, like an urban micro farm setup, this is you're looking at a microgreen tower with the lights. and one of our mega walls. This is 720 ports, two-sided, and it includes everything you needed, your seeds, etc., installation at your location, and training and ongoing support. Okay. And then if you're just looking at a microgreen tower, I mean, we can sell you just a microgreen tower, but invariably people need to know how to do it and need to learn about it. And so we provide that. We have done a couple of projects. We did a project just recently where we just sold the equipment, and we ended up spending hours and hours training because they wanted to use a volunteer model system. And that was very difficult. It was difficult for us as a company because we didn't anticipate how much support was needed. So this way we can say, okay, we're starting at $5,000. That includes your training and ongoing support. It's a real cost for us to engage people with that learning. But once you're up and going, as I said, you're harvesting 18 trays every 3 to 4 weeks. That's a lot of food. You know, 40 pounds of food every week is significant, but you can feed a lot of people. And that's the key here, is that we need to feed a lot of people. I don't know when or how fast, but we need to have that tucked up here somewhere. So this just gives a couple views of what it looks like outside. This Green Magic Homes, by the way, they've actually, they do eco-tourism lodges and resorts. They're pretty cool. Project path, that's pretty straightforward. This is our founders, Kim Parker and Greg Whiteside. Kim is Indigenous background. She worked up in Northern Ontario, Northern communities, and really saw the need for people to have access to food. And Greg is our inventor MacGyver guy. He's like a walking encyclopedia, honestly. Both fantastic people. I really have a lot of respect for them both. And I'm really proud to be helping, working with them. Recently, they just did a brewery in Panama. So I wish these were a little bit bigger, but unfortunately they're not. So you can see the how these are coming together, actually bolting these things together. You can see the buttress on the side. So we actually put in the soya insulation compound on the sides. So just by virtue of the shape of it being kind of rounded, it actually it's able to sustain this arch without a center support. And I actually have some recent inside pictures, if you don't mind. I'm just going to switch over to another screen here. So this is the one in Panama. So you can see it's actually come along pretty good here. They've got the, this is a brewery. And it's actually located in a volcano, not active, of course, in Panama.
Sorry, I think more than one person can't see. I mean, I just see a black field area. It says Lizette has started screen sharing.
Has it started?
No,
it's not.
It says I'm screen sharing.
You might be picking a different, window than the one you think you're picking.
So you can't see it?
No.
Oh, okay. I was trying to go to a Facebook because it was actually located on Facebook, just to show you the inside and such. Beautiful, really nice. So that concludes my presentation. And I'm ready for your questions.
Okay. Lizette, thank you so much. For those who maybe came onto the call late, my name is Karen. I'm from Manitoba, and I am hosting the call tonight, this afternoon. Yeah, let's, if you would like to raise your hand and ask a question. I see that Steve and Tanis both have their hands raised. So one of you go ahead. And we've got about 13 minutes left on the call. So let's get started with a question. Go ahead, Steve. If you want to unmute.
Okay, sorry.
And Tanis, if you'd like to unmute.
I'll be quick. I know that was confidential information, Lizette, and I don't know if you're allowed or willing to share the PowerPoint presentation, but I would sign a non-disclosure as well. I'd send you an email and I could sign a non-disclosure, and then you could send it over if that be, if that's okay.
That's cool.
No problem. Awesome. Yep.
I see somebody asked, not viable in Canada, but yes, it is. This is viable year round in Canada. It's even viable in the Sahara Desert. So.
Hi, Lizette. Thanks for coming back again this week. I was so, honest to God, I've been not thinking about this nonstop for a week. I'm just like, oh my God, it's here. I just wanted to learn so much more. And I'm telling you, you blew my mind. It was more than what I expected. And my only question is like, where do I sign up? But I know that there's other things, the other factors that we have to consider. But I actually just had a small question regarding mushrooms, because mushrooms, I think, is like one of the most underutilized things out there that we could be eating for our health. And it did say mushrooms on your list, but is it any kind of mushrooms? Like, because there's the reishi, like the chaga, it comes from the birch trees, but like there's so many other different types of mushrooms. So is there ones that maybe you couldn't use?
We haven't had anybody growing them inside of them as yet, but I do know that growers are trying to grow them in their house, and they like a lot of CO2 and they're high humidity. They're growing them in bags now and stuff like that. So I really think you could probably actually buy mushroom kits. And because we're controlling the environment, absolutely perfect for this. The same as storing wine or aging cheese or anything that needs a controlled environment, the structure will work for that. And you are right. Mushrooms are very high value food, highly packed with nutrition and medicinal qualities.
Yes. Oh, I just love it, Lizette. Thank you so much again.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I do have a couple of questions, Lizette. First of all, at the beginning when you showed the agro tunnels, I was just looking at the spacing between them. Is there any reason for the spacing in those photos? It just depend on the project or anything?
The ones that are close together, I think are really for illustration purposes, to show you the different configurations that you can have. And again, it depends on where they're located. So let's say they're in a moderate climate. They wouldn't necessarily need to have the earth berming over top. You would probably do it because it's aesthetically pleasing and it blends in with the environment. So again, it really depends on what the end user wants. These are not structures that you live in. These are considered agricultural buildings. So using it as such, they can be places that people live in, but that's under a different type of regulation and building code.
Thank you. Next week on the Think Tank, we're going to be talking about community gardens. So I hope you'll be on the call next week as well, because I think that would be an interesting discussion too, to look at how these structures could become a part of community gardens across Canada, which of course are, you know, very seasonal. And the other thing I wanted to say was about many, many months ago on the Think Tank, or no, maybe it was the Monday night Life Force Canada calls, Karen Klassen had interviewed Michael Tallinger, and we talked about the One Small Town projects. And I think that would be an interesting discussion to have too, in regards to his One Small Town model and the town taking on a structure like this to feed the people and provide income and jobs and that sort of thing for a community. So I'd love to see a discussion about that. I see Tanya has her hand raised, and Grace. So if you wanna unmute whoever wants to go up first, go ahead and ask your question.
Hi. Lizette, nice to see you again. Yeah, this is pretty eye-opening. Just a couple of questions. One of the things I know that's, I do see that you can grow things like root vegetables, because I know one of the things that's a comment about this kind of aeroponic especially is that you really can only grow, they're very highly nutritious, but they're low calorie density. So it's not enough to fill you up, if you know what I mean. You still need some starches like, you know, root vegetables, grains maybe, and of course protein to actually have enough calories to live. I gather the things that give the higher caloric density are completely different structures, are they? I missed the very beginning. Was there like a, would you use those bins for that kind of thing?
Yes, we do. You would use the growing bins.
Okay.
Again, and they're in,
sorry.
They're in, they're used in regions where they can't grow root vegetables.
Okay.
Because it's more economical for them than shipping vegetables to the north.
Well, I know. And I mean, potatoes and carrots and those kinds of things are cheap to grow in a place that you can grow them. But yeah, getting them, they're heavy, and getting them to where you need them, people need that kind of caloric density unless they're, you know, seriously eating.
Yes.
Eels and whatever else the northern people traditionally ate. What about something like squash? I see you got zucchini, but what about like the heavy duty squash, like a winter squash? Can you grow that kind of a thing?
You know, I don't believe that we're limited to what we grow. It's okay. About supporting the fruit of it. Okay.
Because you got zucchini on there, but winter squashes have a long season. I've never tried growing them where we live in Canmore in the mountains. So, because I think I pick things that have like a 60-day growing season or less. Because we're in the mountains. Okay. And then the other thing, I just wonder, because this is a big topic, I haven't heard us talk about it, but it's just seeds, seed accessibility, seed saving, seed producing. Where do you get your seeds? Do you even dig into the whole food seed security and access thing? Because that's, you know, there's these seed, what do they call it? Banks, vaults, really literally, where certain, elites and whatever are trying to make it almost illegal, like in some places in the world, that you can't even save your own seeds. You can't save any kind of a GMO seed. You've got to buy them. Like, what's the?
So there are there are seed savers groups across Canada, mm-hmm. and they have very specific criteria in order to preserve those seeds. It is a concern. It's not something that our company deals with only because our hands are full with what we're doing, but I would suggest that at some point Life Force as a group should probably buy a seed company and or partnering with local farmers who can provide you the seeds that you need. In terms of the migraines, they have the biggest draw on seeds, no doubt.
Yeah, for sure. And I brought that up before.
Yeah, there are commercial seed growers that you can go to that deal strictly with farmers because they're buying 150 kilograms at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Think of like wheatgrass or think of sunflowers or those are the bigger ones. So I think there's West Coast Seeds, there's William Dams in Ontario, there's there might be a couple of other really big ones. That's all they do is supply farmers with seed for fields. And that's where you're going to get your best price. Okay. When you get into some of the other stuff, I paid upwards of $40-$50 for about 500 grams of, say, radish seed, which is for microgreens. Now, radish is good, you know, as a microgreen. They're kind of spicy, and I'm experimenting with different types because I'd like to, you know what they're like. Like you say, not a high caloric counting kind of vegetable. You're going to get nutrients from vitamins, etc., vitamins and minerals. For example, like broccoli, high anti-cancer fighting property. So do you want to grow those? Yeah, probably. Same with turnips, very high in sulfur. If you think about the food as your medicine, right, then you're going to kind of go, well, what kind of things are they telling us we really need? And let's grow them as microgreens so that becomes part of your medicine. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah. Now, in terms of seed savings, like I said, there should be local groups in every province that are doing that. And it could be part of the strategy of what a community would do is to let some of the produce go to seed. So think about starting your garden in the spring, community garden. All of that can start right in a grow wall so that they're, you know, already 4 or 5 inches high, and then you plump them in the ground. Now you've already got a big head start on what you can harvest. And you can always leave plants to go to seed, so you can always continually have that seed for the next season.
Yeah, and I do find, like, I've tried saving seed here, and there's things like bok choy, that kind of thing, or that goes to seed pretty quickly, and I've saved that kind of thing. But I've was trying to save my lettuce seed last year, and it didn't even finish doing its thing before we got frost and snow. So,
right, yeah.
So I don't think it's not realistic. I don't know where it would be realistic, even in Alberta, to actually.
Well, it may be that it's interiorly. Now, again, remember, we can use one seed and harvest for a couple months at a time on one seed. So we don't have a high requirement on that level for, you know, kilograms of seed.
Mm-hmm.
But it may be that some plants are grown specifically for that.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. Well, thank you. But well, I guess, yeah, Karen, I guess better add that to the list of things to consider.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got three people with their hands up, and we've got a couple minutes for just about.
I'm good for time, so whatever works for you guys, okay?
Yeah, so yeah, Grace is next, and then DK and Yaz.
So my question is, how would you figure out what your community eats so you know what to grow? Like, what do you have any kind of thoughts about how to start that kind of process?
Literally, I would just take the list and just say, hey, what do you like to eat? Here's a list, and then and literally just take a count.
All righty.
Yeah, I don't think it has to be complicated. And you might have people say, hey, well, what about, like, because you think about the immigrant communities that have different food tastes. And right. I'm talking with some groups right now, and they're like, well, we want to grow cassava, you know, because it's a low, it helps with sugar regulation, you know. And you go, oh, yeah, okay, I hadn't thought about it. Well, it's a root vegetable. So, you know, can it grow in that environment? But maybe it's turmeric, because that's a spice that's used quite regularly. I talked with one lady, she wanted to grow teff because she could make gluten-free pancakes. Now, teff is grown in Africa, but I found that you can get the seed. So then you have to grow the seed and then harvest it and process it in the way that you would to make those kinds of foods. But one of the things... it's just making me think about a question earlier was about how do we deal with nutrient dense foods. And if you're not a vegetarian, you do eat meat. You can actually grow fodder for cattle so that they've got a better nutritional profile than a lot of the grain fed.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So, and basically fodder is like every week we grow sheets of grass that you can give to them, and it just improves their digestion, improves their health overall.
Good. Thank you for reminding me.
You're welcome.
Pisces.
DK, you're next.
Well, I was just wondering, the answer is probably yes. I think it was called the micro tower. It was like $5,000. And that, like, if you had an apartment big enough, could you use it?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So, you know, you don't need an agro tunnel to grow food, okay? You can use it in a closet as long as you got enough room. Okay. I had a cold storage room in the back, and I just stripped everything out. I painted the walls gloss white, and I put some extra plugs in, and that's my grow room. But the key things, if you're growing in your house, is to be watching your humidity level, because if you have high humidity, which happens through the transpiration of the plants growing, you'll start to grow mold in your house. You don't want that. Okay. So you do need, you know, a thermometer, and you need a humidity gauge, and use a dehydrator in order to remove any of that water that may be in your room. And then of course your temperature. So you don't want it too hot or too cold. You'd want to have a fan, because you want to be able to circulate the air around a little bit. It's like plant yoga, right? Build stronger roots. So yes, absolutely. In fact, there are a lot of resources online, and some people have grown in their apartment or their basements enough to, you know, make $100,000 a year. The key is you have to have the customers. And the challenge right now with all the restaurants being shut down is that they're not buying. And if you can get into a grocery store, then that's good. Or as a community supported agriculture where people buy, have a share of what you produce every week. And then you, in the case of the farm in Pennsylvania, people come to them. You don't want to be, I mean, you could be running all over the place, but if you had a group of 10 people that said, yeah, every week or every 2 weeks, I want 50 or 100 grams of, you know, sunflowers or whatever, then you're off to the races. That's the key thing. So you can do this on a shoestring, no doubt. Get your seed.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yes, go ahead with your question.
Looks like Yaz left.
Sorry, I was muted. There you are. So I was speaking to myself, sorry. Thank you, Lizette, for the information. And just to add on to what DK was asking, like for example, for I guess for a smaller scale operation, perhaps in an apartment or a single family home, like one of those aeroponic walls you showed in the presentation, I think has like around 162 ports or something like that. It's just like a single wall. Would you recommend it that it has have its own like grow room, like your cold storage room, like with a door so you can close it off from the rest of the living space? Because of the temperature and humidity, might be different.
I actually took the wall, I took my door right off because I just didn't want to close it in. But if you know, like you, let's say you have a garage, right? And it's insulated. You could do something in there. You could do it in, you know, let's say on your living room because you've got space around it, right? And you, it's easy to put up a fan for airflow. If you're just trying to feed your family, maybe a few people, yeah, you could get a bigger wall. They're more economical the bigger that you get, but that doesn't mean that you can't. My wall that I have is 40 ports and it was $2,500. But I figure, well, you know, that's a lot for, you know, 40 plants, but then I really like eating it fresh. And now I don't have to really think about, you know, getting a head of lettuce and throwing it out because it's so wet already or something. And with the new systems, you can scale them up. So I don't know if I've answered your question or not, but yeah, you don't have to have a grow room.
So you don't have to have a dedicated room just for growing. So you can put it in the living room and the system won't produce or alter the humidity or temperature of the living space too much, so both the plants and people can coexist.
Yeah, for sure. Again, it doesn't excuse you from, you know, getting a humidity meter. You want to monitor that because if you're over 50%, you're going to get mold in your house. So then you just plug in a dehumidifier to take the water out of the air. In the summer, you'll probably find it's much higher. In the winter, it'll be much lower because you've got your heating system that's drying the air out, right? So like right now, my room is like at 40%, which is pretty low. I'm not going to try to humidify it in any way. But in the summertime, I will put the dehumidifier on and I can collect that water and I can use that water to water my plants because it's clean, it's pH balanced, and it's free.
Right.
Sort of.
As long as it's maintained, the humidity is maintained, then there shouldn't be any issues.
That's correct.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much, Lizette.
You're welcome.
Grace, you still got your hand up. Did you have another question?
No, I didn't. Sorry.
Thank you. So I have one last question and then we'll close this. Lizette, could you just speak about, I understood you to say that these systems are manufactured in Colorado and then they would be shipped to Canada. You know, we're looking at not only, you know, taking back control of our food supply in Canada, but also manufacturing and things of that sort. So are there any plans then to have systems manufactured in Ontario or elsewhere?
So the original version of our walls, we're out of New Jersey. And then the 2.0 version that we're dealing with right now is out of Colorado. That's because he went to New Jersey, saw the other walls and said, I can make this better. And I mean, that's what our company is about, is like, what's the best that's out there? And this guy was so committed. His name's Rick Langille. So committed to what's going on and that the necessity for growing food locally, that he bought a plant and bought the materials and is up and running, like in probably record time, a year and a half, quite a hefty investment. There will be a distribution point out of Winnipeg. And I guess if we got to the point where, you know, he couldn't keep up, that might be a consideration. But at this point, I don't foresee us having a supply issue unless all of the plastics in the world become unavailable.
Yeah, thank you. I think it is an important thing that we look at as well, right? Again, yeah. Just to, as I say, to bring manufacturing back to Canada and have, you know, create the jobs and whatnot. So it would be an important thing to look at if that would be a possibility with this company. So thank you.
I think if you create the need, they would consider it.
Yeah, great.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation today. And we'll see everybody again next Friday, same time. So all right. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your time. I really appreciate the invitation.
Thank you.
Appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
See you again soon.